Well, it's a joy to be here. Welcome to Newark Evangelical Church. We give you a warm welcome to our fellowship, to our church today. Church may not be, as we've mentioned most weeks, what we've come to expect, but we've still had the joy of fellowshipping and worshipping together. So we indeed give you a warm welcome to the Lord's house. It's where the people gather together in His name. And we're going to start with a few words from Scripture, from Psalm 84. Just a few words at the commencement and a few words at the end of the psalm. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. And then moving down to verse 10, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. O Lord Almighty, blessed is the man who trusts in you. What wonderful words. And we're going to really open our service today by singing a song, Bless the Lord, O my soul. The verse comes up, the verse echoes these words. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Let's sing unto the Lord.
Oh,
Bless the Lord, O my soul. What wonderful words. Let's come to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name. We lift your name, as it were, on high. Lord, help us to exalt your name today. Father God, we are gathered together in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus. We thank you for the price that he paid on Calvary. We thank you for all that he means, that all that he is, and all that he will be. And we pray for those that day when he returns in majesty and triumph. Father, we pray that we may indeed have a sense of your Holy Spirit's power on our presence this morning. Father, we pray as we open your word later that we will be encouraged by the words of Scripture. We pray for our pastor as he shares your word with us. And Father, we think of our wider fellowship. We especially pray for Beryl in the recent loss of her dear husband, Roy. And we pray your blessing on her and your support and love. And we thank you for the fellowship who's been rallying around her. We pray for the wider church here. We pray, Lord, for our broken world. And Father, we bring the virus to you again. And the sense of uncertainty. We pray for other nations that are struggling. Father, we sometimes cannot understand these things, but we commit them all to you. We pray for your help and your protection, for your compassion on us. We pray, Lord Jesus, that we may indeed gain strength from our own fellowship and from your word today. So, Father, we count it a real joy to be here together, to praise your name, to listen to your word, and we pray your continued presence with us as we seek to honour and praise your name. In Jesus, amen. Thank you. It's just want to bring a couple of notices to you. It's a joy, as I said, to welcome you today, but that continues this afternoon at 4:30, where we have a Zoom service, and that will be including communion. So if you're part of our fellowship here at Newark Evangelical Church, we give you a really warm welcome to that. So thank you. We are also continuing with our Christianity Explored course, and Pastor Andrew can inform you of that, and just pray for our time together. It's tomorrow night, Monday, so again on Zoom. A joy to see you. Thank you. Well, many of you sorry, I've jumped a bit. We have a reading, most important part. We have a reading from the book of Genesis. Now, our pastor has been sharing from the book of Genesis right through characters from Abraham and Isaac and Esau and Jacob. And we're now actually looking at Jacob again today. And we're reading from Genesis 32, verses 22 to 32. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched, as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you've struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. Amen. Well, we will now finally go over to CSI. It's become a firm favourite of the fellowship, and it's a joy to go over to the CSI studio. So I'll hand over that now. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome back to another episode of Children's Scripture Investigation. I'm Dave, your host, and here are our top stories this morning. As of this weekend, the government is hoping to ease some of its lockdown measures. My producer came to me and told me that this is great news. He tells me he might even be able to have somebody else co-presenting with me in my studio, my clean, tidy studio. As you can tell by the look on my face, I'm beside myself with glee at this news. I did have some other news to report on some other worldwide major events, but in the light of what my producers told me, this hardly seems important anymore. Seriously? Co-presenting? But seriously, this morning we're going to be looking into the life of another fine Christian, a man called Hudson Taylor. His name may be familiar to you. And in a few moments' time, we're going to cut across to our time lapse, where hopefully our top crack investigative reporter, Miss Anna Meacham, will be getting herself back in time, where she is hoping to meet up with Hudson Taylor and interview him whilst out there in China, working as part of the inland mission. So, over to you, Anna, in the labs. How's it going?
Hello. Oh, it's Patrick. Ah. I can't think of back.
I haven't seen you for so long.
I know. I didn't think you'd be back so soon after the rescue.
Oh, well, yeah. They said I can come straight back after they rescued me and I need some money. So, you know, I came straight back to work. It's amazing.
It is. I need to go to China, late 1800s.
Any time more specific than that?
No,
okay. Oh, you've got to step in there.
Yep.
There we go. Right, here we go.
Hello,
my name's Anna. I'm one of the CSI team. We investigate Christians throughout history.
Oh, that explains the attire then.
Thank you. What are you up to?
Oh, I was just attending to some patients.
Ah, so you're a doctor then?
Well, sort of. First and foremost, I'm a missionary from England. But yes, I am helping these people because I learnt about to become a doctor from England.
I see that you adopt the Chinese way of living and dressing.
Well, yes, it's important to relate to them and show them that you're like them, just like them, so I can tell them about Jesus.
And my notes don't say, it looks like you've been here a while now, but how old were you when you first came to China?
I was around 21 when I first came to China. Mm-hmm. When I was 18, I started to prepare to come to China, learning the language, and then I studied to become a physician.
Mm-hmm. And I've heard something that your parents knew for a long time that you were going to live in China.
Yeah, that's right. Since I was born, my parents had been praying for me because they really wanted me to become a missionary in China, and their prayer was answered.
Wow, that's a really bold prayer for them to have prayed.
Mm. Well, that's true. Prayer's always been a big part of my life. Mm-hmm. When I was younger, as a teenager, I rebelled against my parents' faith. Mm-hmm. But my younger sister, she was determined and prayed every day that I'd become a Christian, and her prayer was answered too.
Wow, that's an amazing thing. Mm. Refer to my notes. Oh yes, last week I was talking to somebody who I think knows you, C.T. Studd.
Oh, Studd. Yes, I know him. He came with me the second trip to China, but we had to come home early because I wasn't feeling very well, I was a bit ill. So, but God used that for good as well. He helped me continue to translate the Bible into the Chinese language, and also I was able to recruit other people.
And was that easy to get other people to come to China?
Not really, because there's no guaranteed income, and also they have to, like me, dress in the traditional Chinese clothing, which gets some getting used to.
Yeah, I can imagine. You ended up forming an organisation, didn't you?
That's right, the China Inland Mission.
Oh yeah, I think it goes by a different name nowadays.
Oh. Well, God has been so faithful to us, to me, all this time I've been in China. Mm-hmm. China's such a big country, and it takes so many missionaries to try and reach as many people as possible. I prayed once for 70 new missionaries, and God gave us 79. I prayed again for 100, and He gave us 102. Amazing what God can do.
That's a massive amount of people to get going. God's obviously blessed your work here, and made it fruitful.
Right.
Thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
You're welcome.
Nice to meet you, and hope your work continues.
Thank you.
So, boys and girls, there we have it, Hudson Taylor. Another Christian, another missionary, similar to what we found out last week from C.T. Studd. A man who devoted his time and efforts to serving God, not in his own surroundings where he's comfortable, but where God called him to be, and in this case, China. Now for us, we might think that starting a new school in the future is going to be a daunting process. We might think that other challenges in life might be difficult, but imagine going to a whole nother country. A country that's not familiar with you or your way of life. And as such, Hudson Taylor found he had to learn the language. He even found that the best way to get through to them was to dress as they did, to adopt the customs that they had, to live the life of the Chinese, and to integrate into their society, rather than trying to bring his way of life to them. Boys and girls, this may seem like a really overwhelming task. But as Hudson Taylor found out, even from a young age, at 21, he was able to see that there was nothing that he couldn't do if God was helping him with it. That he could overcome these tasks. A man from Wakefield who could go and learn the Chinese language, who could dress and act as them and adopt their customs, simply so that he could share the love of Jesus Christ with them. That's how important it was to him. And as you recall him sharing with Miss Anna Meacham, he also told us that this was a great and overwhelming task that needed much help and much prayer and much support, and God answered those prayers. God was in that work. God believed in Hudson Taylor, and he was able to have those prayers answered for those other people to give up their lives and be a part of that mission too. That mission grew. The Inland Mission became something huge, and a version of that is still there today. And boys and girls, the church in China is huge today. because of people like Hudson Taylor. Well, we're going to go over to our CSI music studios now, and we're going to see if they've cooked up a chorus that we can sing that helps us to think about these things. So guys, in the music studio, it's over to you. Hey guys, welcome back to the CSI music studio. And we were just thinking over what Hudson Taylor was saying, how important Jesus is to him, how precious he is, and the need to then go and share Jesus with loads of other people, in this case, in China, but also to recruit other people to do that as well. And this chorus, with the words just coming up now, is what a wonderful Savior is Jesus. And when we realize how amazing Jesus is, what a wonderful Savior and friend, we can't help but want to go and tell everybody else about it. But this song also talks about what's coming before God in prayer and asking for God's help, just like Hudson did, asking for help for more people to tell everyone about Jesus. So, I'm going to play the music through, and if you're familiar with this chorus, then please sing along. If not, you can learn something new today. Let's go.
What a wonderful Savior is Jesus. What a wonderful friend is He. For He left all the glory of heaven, came to earth to die on Calvary. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. He arose from the grave, hallelujah, and He lives nevermore to die. At the Father's right hand interceding, He will hear and heed our fainted cry. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. He is coming someday to receive us. Will He come to heaven above? What a joy it will be to behold Him, sing forever of His grace and love. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King.
Well, thanks for joining us. Back to you in the main studio. Well, thank you very much. And boys and girls, that's all we have for this week. Thank you for tuning in. We look forward to seeing you back in the studios next week. Until then, goodbye, God bless, and stay safe.
Thank you, Dave and the team, for another great CSI. And thank you, Jeff, for leading our service so far. We're now going to have an update from one of our mission partners, Daniel and Gail Castro. They serve with OMS, One Mission Society, in Spain. And they've got two daughters, Melissa and Ruth. They've both been at university here in the UK. Melissa's recently graduated and Ruth is still studying. They work, as I said, in Spain. They've actually been on home assignment in the UK for a number of months now, so they were already here in the UK when coronavirus hit, so that's delayed their plans a bit in terms of going back to Spain. But I'll tell you a little bit about their work in Spain before we watch their video and their update for us. They work in church development and developing leaders in Spain. They're involved in serving in a local church in a town called Camama, which is near Madrid. And they've still been able to be involved in that, as we'll see from the video, even while they've been back here in the UK. There's also a Christian school in Kamama as well that the church and the mission is involved with. They've also been involved in frontline mission, making contacts with non-Christians, sharing the gospel. They've been part of a church planting team in another town called Mecco, where they lived. And that's not far from Kamama, just outside Madrid. Now, one of the ways that they've been reaching out to people in that area of Spain is through camps. They have summer camps for young people, sports camps, but they also have camps for adults and families around learning the English language. And at NEC, we've sent out two teams now in the past to go and help them in those English camps, a lovely site to the north of Madrid. And I myself went out 1 year to join them with that. And so we've had a long and a fruitful partnership with the Castros. So it's great to be able to hear from them now.
Good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, whenever you're managing to watch this service. Thank you for allowing us to join you in your online service there in Newark. And we're sorry that we can't be with you to give our thanks to you for your support in person. But we do thank you for this opportunity just to greet you and obviously thank you for your support. I hope that you have found ways to stay healthy, both physically, emotionally, as well as spiritually, during this lockdown time, as everything has changed for everyone. And we are adjusting, as I'm sure as many of you have, to the changes in our lives, and the things that we planned have not gone as we planned. But God is in control, thankfully, and we rest in that, and we continue to ask for your prayers.
Yeah, ironically and happily, we have been in touch with the people from Spain even more, much more frequently now, because the church, for example, has all the Sunday services and different meetings throughout the week online on Zoom. So every Sunday we have been able to join them and actually been able to see them and chat to the people. It's actually quite encouraging, thanks to the technology that allows that. A couple of members from the congregation were very, very bad with the virus. They nearly died, and this really brought the church in prayer. And thanks to the prayer of many people, these dear people are now on the way to recovery. So we give thanks, give God thanks for the way in which He is still at work in our lives. You probably have heard of the camp that our mission has. I mean, the camp in which we have done the English camps, and some of you have attended, have been there. Well, because of all the situation, obviously the all the activities were cancelled. We are struggling financially. We are receiving some help from the government to pay salaries and things like that, but we cannot be closed down for much longer. So we would appreciate your prayers for the ministry of the camp. Is a very important ministry in Spain, you know, bringing churches together, offering opportunities of training, of evangelism, and so on. So it is a very key ministry in the church in Spain. So we would like you to pray for the camp as we are assessing the situation on a weekly basis to know how best to act. And we're praying that we'll be able to, maybe in October, be able to reopen the activity so the camp can stay alive. And so we have been in touch with the people from Spain quite a bit. So we are very glad and very grateful for that. So what is next for us?
Well, our plans were to return in September, but that will probably be extended. God knows what's in store, but we do need prayers for Melissa to find work She finished her degree this year, and so she needs to find work and somewhere to live. Ruth will go back into Chester University in September. So once the two of them are settled, then we can hopefully make our way back to Spain. So do pray that God will bring all things together. Mm-hmm. Do pray for the church, for the leadership of the Commandment Church. Do pray for the camp. And we do want to thank you again, as I said, for your support, for your financial support, and especially your prayers. So thank you again for this opportunity to share with you in your service. God bless you all.
One birthday that has been a real encouragement and affirmation to us at this uncertain time is found in Isaiah 41:10 and says, "Fear not, for I am with you. I will help you. I will hold you with my righteous right hand." And how reaffirming that, to know that God is with us in the middle of all this crisis. God is with us. He is by our side, and He is in control. This situation didn't take Him by surprise. So we want to trust Him. We want to Him to fulfill the purposes that He has in each of our lives throughout this crisis. And we hope that is a reality for each of you. We hope that God would bless you and would keep you this time. So we hope to see you at some time in the future, and meanwhile, or in Spain as well. So meanwhile, God bless you and keep you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, let's pray now for the Castros and also for ourselves as we prepare to hear from God's word. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our gospel partnership with the Castro family. We thank you for their many years of mission with OMS. Thank you for all that you have done through them, for the people that you brought into your kingdom, and for the believers that you have strengthened through their ministry. And Father, we thank you that they've been able to keep going in a certain way with that ministry. They've been able to keep in touch with friends and colleagues back in Spain. Thank you that they've been able to take part in the Zoom services of their church in Camarma. And Lord, we do pray for their ministry in Spain. We pray for the camp that's owned and run by OMS. Father, we pray that you would sustain that ministry, that it would be able to keep going even in this difficult climate. We pray that the staff there and the facility itself can be retained, and it can reopen when it's safe to do so, and it can be used for future ministry, for outreach, and for building up your people. But we pray that the contacts that they have with friends in Spain, that they'd be able to continue those contacts and to continue praying for and helping those with whom they work there in Spain. And Lord, we pray that you guide them as they think about heading back at some point. The future for them, as for many of us, is uncertain at the moment. So Father, would you give them peace in this? Help them to trust you. Would you guide them, Lord? And help them to know that you will bring them back to Spain at the right time. We also pray for Melissa, that she would find a job and find somewhere to settle. We pray for Ruth as she continues her studies. Lord, we ask that you would watch over them and bless them as a family. We pray for ourselves now, Lord, as we ask that you would speak to us through your word. May we be ready to listen. May you challenge us, but also build us up in our faith. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. I encourage you to have Genesis 32 open in front of you if you have a Bible there in some form, whether a paper copy or a digital version. It would be great for us to be able to work through that together. As a preacher, it's never an easy job to teach God's word, but there are some passages of the Bible that are more tricky than others, and this is a tricky passage in God's word. At least I found it tricky anyway. I have wrestled as Jacob wrestles with God. I have wrestled with this passage, but I trust that there will be some fruit from that wrestling. I think there are important lessons for us to learn from this encounter that Jacob had with God. There is something of a mystery here. We can't fully understand, I think, what's going on. We have questions that might not be answered about how it is that God is able to come in a human form to wrestle with Jacob, why he does that. But I think this passage is here for us, for a reason. It's here to teach us. And I pray that we would learn the lessons from this passage. And something that can help us when we come across a passage that we might struggle to understand is to look at a little bit wider, to zoom out a little bit and to see what's happening around that passage, what happens in the lead up to it, what happens afterwards, but also to see that particular passage in the wider context of the book and of the whole word of God, and to ask, well, why is it here in God's word? And that's what we're going to try and do this morning. So firstly, let's go back to the first half of Genesis 32. And we see there that Jacob has already been through one trial. He survived 20 difficult years serving his uncle Laban. And now he's heading home. He's heading back to the land of Canaan, back to where his father Isaac lives. So he's gone through one trial, but there is another trial ahead. Because before he returns to the promised land, he needs to deal with his past. And he needs to do something that he's put off for 20 years. He needs to encounter his brother Esau, his twin brother. And you might remember from previous weeks that Jacob tricked Esau out of his birthright and he stole the blessing from him. And so Esau was angry with Jacob and Esau wanted to kill Jacob. And now it seems the chickens have come home to roost. At least that's what Jacob fears. That now Jacob might have his comeuppance 20 years later, that Esau might finally get his vengeance on Jacob. And this fear is intensified when Jacob hears in verse 6 that Esau is coming to meet him with what sounds like a small army. 400 men are coming with Esau to meet Jacob. And he's afraid. He's worried. But right at the start of this chapter, God reassures Jacob of his presence and of his protection. You see that in verse 1. The angels of God met him, just as they met him back in Genesis 28, as Jacob was leaving the promised land. Now as he is about to enter the promised land again, God's angels meet him once more. And Jacob realizes that he's not on his own. He says, this is the camp of God. God is with me. It's just not just me and my people, but the angels of God are here to protect me. And we see also in this encounter that Jacob has changed, that God is doing a work in Jacob. His character is developing from a sly schemer to a prayerful planner. And before we saw Jacob using his wits and using his intellect and using his acting skills to scheme his way to blessing. He used his own means to get what he wanted for himself. But his approach is different now. He still makes plans. So verse 3, he sends out messengers. Verse 7, he splits up his people into two camps for safety. In Verse 13, he prepares a gift to placate his brother Esau. But this planning is rooted not in self-reliance, but in God-reliance. And that's another development in his character. He's gone from self-reliance, and he's moving towards God-reliance. We see this in his prayer in verses 9 to 12. At the heart of it, it's a simple prayer. Save me, because I'm afraid. That's what he asks of God. It's very simple. But it's a prayer that is grounded in a confidence in God, because it's grounded in the promises of God. And Jacob, as he prays, reminds himself of what God has promised him. In fact, the prayer begins and ends with promise. It's bookended with the promises of God. The prayer begins with the promise of the place and the blessing in that place. And it ends with the promise of people and blessing. And as such, it provides us with a model of how we should pray, to remind ourselves as we pray of God's promises, which gives us confidence that God will be with us and help us in the situation that we're in and the needs that we have. And this prayer also helps us to see something else about how Jacob's character is developing. He is moved from grasping to gratitude. Jacob's name means heel grasper. And he got that name because when he came out of his mother, he was grasping hold of his twin brother's heel. And so he was given the name Jacob, the heel grasper. He was also a grasper in another sense. He was a grasper in the sense that he tried to get blessing for himself in the past by his own means. But that attitude of grasping has changed to an attitude of humble gratitude, of receiving instead of grasping. He realizes that all the blessing that he has received in the last 20 years has come to him from God, and he didn't deserve any of it. He hasn't had to grasp hold of it himself. God has given it to him freely and undeservedly. So God has been dealing with Jacob. He's used the last 20 years to teach him painful lessons, to develop his character, to change him from a sly schemer to a prayerful planner, from self-reliance to God-reliance, and from grasping to humble gratitude. But God isn't finished yet with Jacob. And this is where the wrestling match comes in. It's a crucial moment in Jacob's life as he's there on the ford by the river Jabbok. He's about to meet Esau, and he doesn't know how that's going to turn out. He's also about to head back into the promised land. God's promises to bring him back home are about to be fulfilled. But it's also a crucial moment in Jacob's character development as well. And Jacob seems to continue this pattern of planning and praying. So verses 7 to 8, he plans. Verses 9 to 12, he prays. Verses 13 to 21, he plans again. But now here from verse 22 onwards, it seems that he wants to pray once more. And that's perhaps why he spends the night alone. He wants time on his own at this crucial moment to pray. But Jacob is not left alone. A mysterious man comes in the darkness and starts wrestling with him. And he wrestles all night till daybreak. And it sounds like a well-matched fight. Neither can overpower the other until the mystery man touches the socket of Jacob's hip and it's wrenched out of place. And which begs the question, well, if the man was that powerful that he could just touch Jacob's hip and it was wrenched out of place, then why didn't he do that earlier? Why struggle in this wrestling match when clearly he was the more powerful man? Why allow Jacob who is the weaker man, to wrestle with him and not overpower him. We'll come on to that in a moment. But although Jacob now has this injury, his hip is wrenched out of place, he keeps going, he keeps wrestling until the man has to say, "Let me go." It's about to, the sun is about to dawn, about to reach daybreak. But Jacob doesn't want to let him go until he gets blessing. Now on the surface of things, we might think, well, this is just the same old Jacob. He's doing whatever he can to grasp hold of blessing. He's kind of grasping hold of this man as he wrestles with him. He wants to wrestle this blessing. But there is something different about the way that Jacob is approaching this, about the way that Jacob gets this particular blessing. See, the old Jacob was a greedy grasper, a schemer, a deceiver, a trickster. In the past, he won his blessing through lies and deception. But now he's receiving his blessing in a different way, through a struggle, through an honest struggle. And this reflects more the person that Jacob is now becoming. He's not there yet. He's still developing. But with this changing of character comes a changing of name. This man says to him, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel. Because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob won't be called the grasper anymore, the deceiver, the schemer, the trickster. He'll be called now the struggler, because he has struggled with God himself. And Jacob comes to realize that this mystery man is the Lord, that he is seeing God face to face. Even though God didn't give him his name, he knew it was God. And he's amazed that he's come face to face with God, and yet he has lived. His life has been spared. And what's happening here in this wrestling match is that God is showing Jacob in one night what has been happening to him over the last 20 years, and also what's going to lie in store for him in the future. See, these last 20 years, Jacob has been getting regular doses of his own medicine. The deceiver has been deceived. Laban has tricked and lied to Jacob in the way that Jacob did to others before. But what God wants Jacob to see is that his struggles with human beings, his struggles with Laban particularly, has not just been a struggle with a human being. Actually, it's been a struggle with God himself. His 20-year arm wrestle with his uncle has actually been a wrestling with God. God has used Laban. Yes, lying Laban, deceiving Laban. God has used Laban to develop Jacob's character. Through Laban, God has been wrestling with his servant. God has been molding Jacob. He's been turning him from a sly schemer into a prayerful planner. He's been taking away that self-reliance to replace it with God-reliance. He's transforming him from a grasper to one who has an attitude of humble gratitude. So God has used Laban to humble Jacob and to bring him low, but also to build him up, to bless him. So in this wrestling match, Jacob is being shown that his real struggle is not just with human beings, his real struggle is with God himself. And this struggle is needed, it's necessary for Jacob to learn to overcome so that he can receive blessing from God. See, Jacob learned that God's blessing can't just be grasped whenever we want it. God's blessing comes at a cost. There is a struggle before we receive God's blessing. But the struggle is one that God initiates for our good. And it's a struggle that God remains in control of all the way through. And that should have been a great comfort to Jacob. To know that whatever human beings have done to him in the past and whatever human beings might try to do to him in the future, ultimately it was God who was at work. It was God who was wrestling with him. It was God who was testing him and bringing him through these trials, not to punish him, but ultimately to bless him. And just so that Jacob knows that this struggle is going to continue, he leaves this wrestling match with a limp. It's a permanent reminder of God's dealings with him. There's a permanent weakness now, but it's a reminder also of God's grace. Jacob is stripped of his self-sufficiency, but he gains far more than what's taken away. As one writer put it, this wrestling match was defeat and victory all in one. He emerges broken, but he is also blessed. And this is a lesson, as we now look a bit wider in the story of the Bible, and the story of God's people in the Bible. This is a lesson that the people of Israel, Jacob's descendants, needed to learn. They had a permanent reminder of this wrestling match, because in their food laws they weren't allowed to eat the tendon that connected to the hip of any animal. It was a reminder that God himself had touched Jacob's hip. But it's also a significant passage if you were an Israelite reading this, because it's the first time in the Bible that the word Israel has been mentioned. So you're an Israelite, you're reading this, and your eyes pop open because, well, here you are. You are part of Israel. And in a sense, you are in this story as well. So this is where the context comes in again. We need to see that that Genesis was written to a particular group of people at a particular time in history. It was written to the people of Israel. It was written by Moses, and Moses is writing this under the inspiration of God's Holy Spirit to teach God's people something, to teach those people who are going through the wilderness and heading towards the promised land about their origins. That's what the word Genesis means. That's what the book is all about. It's a book of origins, a book of beginnings. It shows us the beginnings of the universe and the human race, but particularly it shows us the beginnings of the nation of Israel. Israelites are being shown their history here as God's camera, as it were, focuses in on this one family. Out of all the families on earth, this one family is brought into focus, because this is the family from whom the nation of Israel would come. We've been seeing recently, haven't we, with events that are happening around us, how it's important to know your past. It's important to look at the events of the past, because they can help us in the present. It's important to know what's happened before so we can move forward in the future. We look back at history and we see that racial tensions and global pandemics are nothing new. These things have happened before. We've been struggling with these issues for generations. And the key thing is to learn from history rather than making the mistakes of history. The people of Israel needed to learn from the past. They needed to learn that just as God was at work in Jacob's struggles, so God was also at work in their own struggles. As they were struggling through the wilderness, God was at work. These 40 years in the desert weren't going to be wasted. God was going to use this time, ultimately, to bless them. You know, they thought coming out of Egypt would be the hard bit, but they were wrong. You try wandering in the desert for 40 years with only manna for food, watching as people in your own generation, friends and family, die off, wondering if you're going to be next, wondering if you're ever going to enter the land of promise. But sadly, the Israelites didn't learn the lessons of the past. They didn't learn from their ancestor Jacob. They didn't learn prayerfulness and reliance on God and gratitude. Instead, they went away from God. Hundreds of years after Jacob, the prophet Hosea preached to the people of Israel. He's been called the deathbed prophet because he was the last prophet to preach to the people of Israel before they left the land of blessing, the land of promise, before they were taken away through God's judgment and the nation fell under the Assyrians. Hosea refers back to Jacob's wrestling match with God. In Hosea 12, verse 3, he says there about Jacob, in the womb he grasped his mother's heel. As a man he struggled with God. He struggled with the angel and overcame him. He wept and begged for his favour. He found him at Bethel and talked with him there. The God Almighty, the Lord, is his name. And the message to Israel, as Hosea points them to their past, is return to the Lord. You must return to your God, maintain love and justice, and wait for your God always. They were to come back to God, to wait for God, just as Jacob did. But they didn't, and so they were carried off into exile. They didn't learn the lesson of the past. So will we? Will we learn the lessons of the past? As we broaden out the context even further to see the context of the whole Bible and ourselves, how this passage applies to us. And we're told in the New Testament that everything written in the past, everything written in the Old Testament, is for our instruction as well. So what can we learn from this? And will we learn the lessons of Jacob's wrestling with God? Will we overcome in the trials that God sends to us? Will we overcome those trials? And will we allow God to do what He wants to do in us through those trials, to develop our character, to change us, like He did with Jacob? You know, the first step is to see that the trials that come into our life are not random events. They don't just come out of nowhere, and they're not to be avoided necessarily at all costs. Those trials come for a purpose. They're all part of God's good and sovereign plan for our lives. The reformer John Calvin said that all Christians in this world are wrestlers. All of us are wrestling because the Lord exercises us with various kinds of conflicts. He says, for as all prosperity flows from God's goodness, so adversity is either the rod with which He corrects our sins or the test of our faith and patience. God is not only the author of our blessings, He is also the author of our afflictions. And in these trials and in these tests, we must wrestle with God. Ultimately, He wants to bless us in these things. But often the blessings come out of buffetings. John Newton, the famous pastor and hymn writer who wrote Amazing Grace, he knew something about trials. In his former life as a slave trader, he was once caught up in a violent storm on the Atlantic. His ship nearly sunk. Later on, he endured a 7-year struggle to enter the ministry. He knew what it was like to face disappointments. That through many dangers, toils, and snares, he had come personally. He knew what it was like to wrestle with these things, to wrestle with God in times of trial. But he also saw the proper response to those trials. Not to fight against them and not to flee from them, but to submit to God in our trials. To allow God to do in us what he has planned to do through our trials. Not to resent our trials and complain and get bitter like the children of Israel did, but to trust God. And to, in his power, overcome in our trials. And he wrote about this in the final verse of one of his hymns. I asked the Lord that I might grow. These inward trials I employ, from self and pride to set you free, and break the schemes of earthly joy, that thou mayst find your all in me. This is what God was doing in Jacob's struggles, in his wrestling match. God was setting Jacob free from self and pride, breaking his scheming, so that Jacob could find his all in the Lord. And sometimes these trials leave us with a limp. Some of us have permanent reminders of the trials that God has brought us through. We have a permanent reminder of our wrestling with God, of our struggle. It might be a physical reminder, it might be an emotional scar, but we feel that weakness. And that weakness is there by design so that we learn not to trust in ourselves, but in God. The Apostle Paul had the same experience. He was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment him. But though Satan was at work, ultimately it was God who was controlling this situation. God was controlling and at work in this trial that Paul went through. So the Lord says to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. And so that's why Paul, rather than fleeing from his trials, he embraced his trials. He wrestled through his trials. He was able to delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For in his weakness, he knew that God was at work, that God would give him strength to keep going and to overcome, just as God did for Jacob in his own wrestling match. I wonder, are you in a hard place right now? Are you in a place where it feels that all you're doing at the moment is you're struggling? Every day just feels like a struggle. And you don't know when that struggle is going to come to an end. God has brought you to that place. God is using that struggle. Or maybe there is a person in your life that is causing difficulties at the moment. Maybe somebody at work. Maybe somebody in your own family. Or maybe just struggling with the needs of somebody that you love. And those needs are overwhelming. And you're struggling. God has brought that person into your life. God has brought those struggles into your life for a reason, for a purpose. He does it not to crush us, but ultimately to bless us. He brings these trials into our lives to set us free from self and pride, to break our scheming for earthly joy, so that we would find our all in Him. And you know, in the midst of the struggles, rather than seeking the first door to escape through, we fix our eyes on Jesus. We remember that the angel of God who wrestled with Jacob is pointing us forward to Jesus, to God becoming a man, to God entering into our struggle, to God wrestling with us in human form, battling with our sin and our pride, breaking our scheming so that we can find our all in Him. But you know, in this struggle, when God entered the world through Christ, God was left with a limp. It was Jesus who bore the suffering that we deserve. Jesus bore the punishment that we deserve. He bore the cost of our sin so that we could be set free, and that we could enjoy eternal blessing with God. Let's pray together. Our Father, in this passage, we see a mystery. We see you coming into this world in human form to wrestle with your servant Jacob, to teach him, to develop him, to leave him with a limp, but also to give him a great blessing. But there is an even greater mystery, a wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King of Heaven, who would come into this world as a man clothed in flesh, to come and to wrestle with us in our darkness, in our distress, in our longing. Lord Jesus, we are amazed that you would condescend to come and to join us in our struggles, so that we can be set free from sin, and so that we could receive the eternal blessing of God. We praise you, Lord Jesus. You are our hope in every trial. You are our confidence, and we look to you. In your name and in the power of your Spirit, amen. Let's sing our final song together. The words will be on the screen. Let's come and behold the wondrous mystery of God coming in the flesh, in the person of Christ, to join us in our struggle.
Fulfillment of the In the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption. See the fire.
Joining us for this online service. It's been great to have you with us. And do remember that we have another service today at 4:30. It's on Zoom and it's a communion service. So just remember, if you want to take part in the communion part of the service, to have some bread and some wine or juice available with you at home so we can share in the Lord's Supper together. And details of that service will be on Faith Life. And may God bless you and keep you in this weekend.